here on my run. I'm 9.5 miles in, and there's this gigantic, never seen anything like it in the city before. Check this out. Wow. Look at that thing. All right.
Bye, guys.
Thank you. Look at that boat. Now, I love running in New York City for about a million reasons, but one of those reasons, one of the main reasons, is days like today. Like when I saw that gigantic ship and then you see all the tourists with their cameras, people travel from all around the world just to see this city. And I think because I've lived here for 15 years, it's easy to forget how special that is, but running makes me think about it just a little bit more for like 2 hours a day, every day. Get into things today. I need to give you just a super quick update on my sunglasses. And with that, I need to start by saying my purple mirrored glasses, they're gone. They're gone forever. I mean, I could buy another pair, but the pair that I had, they're gone. They're dead. They were given a burial at sea. See, this weekend was my friend Neve's wedding, and I actually officiated his wedding. I think I did a pretty good job.
You may kiss the bride.
And after the wedding, we went to the beach, and I had a few to drink, and at the beach, I thought it'd be a good idea for me to try to surf in a gigantic inflatable swan. At one point in time, I had my glasses on while surfing that gigantic inflatable swan. My little brother pushed me into a wave, because I did surf it, and then crashed. And when I came up, glasses gone. We searched for them under the water. We didn't find them. Purple glasses gone. So, when I got back to the studio, I went through my inventory of sunglasses, and I had first these gradient lens ones. If you see, it's like the lens is lighter down here and darker up here, gradient lens. I don't like the way they look. I think they're a little bit creepy. Then I had my red ones, and I like these red ones, but I broke these red ones, so they're no good. So I went back to the Frosted Classics. Now these are obviously the best ever. The trouble with these though is that I had broken the arm off of the right side. So I took the arm off of my red ones. I cannibalized it, put them on these, and now the glasses are my Frosted ones, cannibal edition. Cool, right? The hardest part of having a book club is finding books that I think enough of you would be interested in for me to actually recommend. Today I'm going to recommend a book that I would venture to say most of you, a lot of you, some of you have already read, but it's sort of an unequivocal smash hit, so I think this one has universal appeal. I should also say, as a caveat, I read this book 5 years ago, but this book as a book is about to expire, and that's why I'm featuring it in the book club, not because I just read it or just discovered it. In fact, I read it years ago, but now's the time for you to read it if you're interested. The book's called Ready Player One. It's a sci-fi book. I'm not particularly into sci-fi books, but this book was a wild ride. I thought it was really, really fantastic. Not everybody agreed, but for the most part, named one of the best books of 2011 by Entertainment Weekly, San Francisco Chronicle, Village Voice, Chicago Sun-Times. I do think it's one of the best sci-fi books I've read in a very, very long time. But here's why this book's about to expire, and here's why I'm recommending you read this book now. So the story takes place in 2044. 2044, the world's really come to a dark place. Pollution, global warming, war. The world is not a nice place to live. But there's this guy in this book, and he created a video game, VR World, that you live in, and it's awesome there. So a lot of the people of the planet Earth in 2044 spend most of their time in this virtual reality world. In the book, the fictional video game creator that made the VR world was a child of the 1980s, and he's obsessed with 1980s pop culture. So the entire book is so laden with 1980s pop culture references that it makes it like the most nostalgic, amazing, like
1985.
References to movies like Better Off Dead, Real Genius, Ghostbusters, War Games, and John Hughes movies like The Breakfast Club, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, 16 Candles, Pretty in Pink, Weird Science. All those movies, like the movies that I love from my childhood, they're all wrapped up within this story that takes place 50 years after those movies were made. So it's a great book, great story. If you're into sci-fi or gaming or anything like that, you'll be into this. If you're a nerd at all, well, if you're a nerd at all, you probably already read it, but if you're a nerd at all, you'll probably like this book. But here's where I'm concerned. Here's why I say that this book is about to expire as we know it. Now, a year before this book was even published, there was a bidding war to see who could get the rights to turn it into a movie. That's how much they knew that this story would lend itself to being a great movie. In the end, Warner Brothers won that bidding war, and last year, 2 years ago, they announced that Steven Spielberg
okay,
was going to direct the movie about this book. And obviously that's great for a lot of reasons. One, because Steven Spielberg is one of the greatest living directors. Two, because Steven Spielberg is also a product of the 80s. I mean, the guy made Indiana Jones, E.T., Poltergeist, Gremlins, Back to the Future, Goonies, and about a dozen other smash hit movies from the 80s. He literally is a product of what this book, so much of this book is about. But that concerned me because the magic of this book is the nuance, the specificity, just the obscene level of detail it goes into about these pop culture references that sort of guide you through the entire, and I just don't think that you can capture all of those details in a movie the way you can in a book. And because of the bidding war and because it's Spielberg, you know that this movie, even if it sucks, I don't think it's gonna suck, but even if it does suck, you know that everybody's gonna go see it because they're gonna spend $1 zillion promoting this thing, which means the minute the movie comes out, when you talk about Ready Player One, people are gonna think you're talking about the movie and not the book. See, books, literature in general, is about community. You read a book, you talk about a book, you talk to your friends about that book, you tweet about that book, you look up online, you research that book. And the minute this blockbuster is gonna come out, I think that this work of literature is going to be marginalized, and a lot of like what makes this extraordinary is gonna fade away into the abyss, and we're only gonna talk about what Spielberg made. And that's why I'm recommending this book now. Take this as a literary experience instead of a cinematic one. That's about to go away, and soon when you bring this up, people are gonna say, oh yeah, I saw that movie. Now let's talk about this trailer for a minute, because it is Spielberg and it is amazing.
They called our generation the missing millions. Missing not because we went anywhere. There's nowhere left to go.
I've watched about 50 times, and the Gunter in me has found a bunch of interesting little clues. I also found a lot of these on web forums, but still. At the very beginning, when Parzival first walks into the Oasis, he passes by on his left Harley Quinn and Deathstroke. Then when you see all the Sixers in uniform rushing in to get into their cars, if you look on the right, for a second, you can see the A-Team van. And then this is my favorite. When the race is taking place, there's a split second where H's monster truck bursts through all of the Sixers' cars and they go flying. On the roof of one of the cars, you see a QR code. If you actually scan in that QR code, it takes you to an IOI recruitment page, a real website. There, that's the QR code. Come on, that's awesome. And then like if you look on Reddit, there's about 1,000 other of those like little tiny little Easter eggs in the trailer, which leads me to believe that Spielberg is gonna respect all the crazy details in this, but even so, like seeing them on screen is fun. It's not the same as... All right, so that's my review. Go check out Ready Player One before it comes out as a Steven Spielberg movie.
The magic number 3. Somewhere in this hip-hop soul community was born 3, they stubbed me, and that's the magic number.
You look fine!
So how was your day?
Don't you like seeing people stare at themselves in windows?
You look pretty today.
Thanks.
Do not unplug my phone! Candace and I have a date tonight. It's a double date. We have a double date tonight.
Difficult preaching is posthumous pleasure. Pleasure in preaching starts in the heart. Something that stimulates the music in a measure. Measure
every time
the music.
We left the house, he had that huge camera.
Just,
and I was like, that's
it. Doing
no,
it right
no
now.
More.
How was our date tonight?
Very good.
It was good. We double dated with these guys. How was our date, Max?
It was great.
Priscilla?
It was incredible.
But it's not over yet.
It's not over.
Things are just getting started.